All about the TDSS rootkit. Back in the days of Windows 95, there were only viruses which were basically evil pranks, so programmers could show their programming skills. Today, 16 years later, viruses have been split into many different categories, and all forms of malicious software together are now called malware. Malware programming has turned into a whole business that can bring you money on the table, but it can be dangerous. Every second, around 10,000 malware files are created or reprogrammed. But out of all those billions out there, one is the most sophisticated, the TDSS rootkit. The name of that thread is TDSS rootkit, and its programmers call it the TDL. The TDL made its first appearance in 2008, and its developers have been perfecting it once in a while. So we are coming today, 3 years later, to have more than 4 major releases of that rootkit. There are 4 major variants of the TDSS, the TDL, TDL2, 3 and 4. Until December 2010, the TDSS program had a basic structure that changed, containing models of non-malicious programs, program Cs. That meant that the program had been solved. After TDSS gets sold to the creators of Cs, they use it along with the search engine to redirect malicious file, also created by Cs, managing to infect over 3 million computers in 1 month. Why did they sell it? Well, they sold only the TDL3 variant, though TDL4 had been already released. There was no competition for the TDL4 one. Also, a bit later, this proved to be true, with TDL4 taking over more than 4.5 million computers worldwide. And one of the new features we see in TDL4 is the encrypted connection. Compared to previous version, they have an updated algorithm encrypting the protocol used for communication between infected computers at .NET command and control servers. The cyber criminals replaced RC4 with their own encryption algorithm using source offset operations. The domain names to which connections are made are, and the PSH parameter from the cfd.ini file are used as encryption keys. Readers may recall that one of the distinguishing features of malware from the TDSS family is a configuration file containing description of the key parameters used by various models to maintain activity logs and communications with command and control servers. Compared to version 3, there are only negligible changes to the format of the configuration file. The main addition is the BSH parameter, an identifier which identifies the copy of the malware or which is provided by the command and control server the first time the bot connects. This identifier acts as one of the encryption keys for subsequent connections to the command and control server. And TDL4 became the first thread in the whole malware history to be an antivirus program. TDL4 infects master boot record, so it can load fairly any time you boot up your system, and it uses a bunch of techniques to hide itself and its associated files from traditional antivirus software. In order not to get the user's attention, the TDL4 rootkit removes other malicious applications that have been installed on the system. As discussed in the previous section, TDSS has a built-in antivirus to remove other malicious software installed on the victim's computer. Well, it helps it. On the one hand, it fights cybercrime competition, while on the other hand, it protects itself from nasty malware that can block its executions and access. TDL4 access is the CAD network. One of the most outstanding features of TDL4 is that it throws the CAD.dll model into your system, which allows you to access the CAD network. You might wonder what cyber criminals have to do with the public file exchange network. The technique of controlling botnets through P2P is known for quite some time now. Also, until now, these were closed protocol connections created by the attackers themselves. In contrast, TDL4 uses a public P2P network in order to transmit commands to all infected computers of the botnet. How TDL4 uses the CAD network? Well, the cyber criminals make a file called KDZ eRules accessible on the CAN network. The file is encrypted and contains a list of commands for TDSS. Computer infected with TDSS receives a command to download and install the CAD.dll model. Once installed, CAD.dll downloads the file notes.dat, which contains publicly accessible list of IP addresses of CAD network servers and clients. The CAD.ELO model then sends a request to the CAD network to search for the KDC ERLS file. Once the KDC ERLS file has been downloaded and encrypted, CAD.ELO runs the command which KDC ERLS contains. Well, I below is a list of some encrypted commands from the KDC ERLS file. First of all, we've got the search search config command, which searches CAD for a new KDC ERLS file, like an update. LOADC downloads and runs the executable. Config write to the config ini file. Searches the CAD for a file of the CAD network. It publishes a file on CAD. And knock uploading new nodes the data file to the CNC, which contains a list of CAD server clients IP addresses, including those in fact with TDSS. Well, the most interesting command is knock. This command allows a cyber criminalist to create their own CAD P2P, the clients of which are exclusively TDSS infected computers. Essentially, the TDSS board of CAD.ELO model is more or less the same as CMD.ELO in terms of control function, barring notes the DAD files containing a list of IP addresses of KAD or CAD clients in addition to KDZ ERL rules, which contains a command to download a new notes.dad file from cybercriminal servers. The owners of the botnet can both include their infected computers, the publicly accessible CAD network, and remove them from the network. The publicly accessible CAD network contains no more than 10 TDSS infected computers. This makes replacing the KDZ ERLS file as inefficient as possible, which prevents such cybercriminals from taking control of the botnet. The total number of TDSS infected computers on the CLID network number tens of thousands. And furthermore, access to CAD makes it possible for the cybercriminals to download any files to botnet machines and make them accessible to the P2P users. This includes adult content files and stolen databases. The key threat that starts a botnet pool is that even when its command and control to CAD centers are set down, the botnet owners will not lose control over infected machines. However, the system does face two major obstacles. By using the publicly accessible CAD network, the cyber criminals still run the risk of fake botnet commands. When developing the CAD.ELO model for maintaining communication with the CAD network, code with a GPL license was used. This means that the offers are in violation of the licensing agreement. In addition to its known hardware function, TDL4 has added some new models to its arsenal. This presentation has already touched on the antivirus function of the P2P model. The owners of TDSS have also added several other models to their malware and now offer services such as anonymous network access via infected machine and 64-bit support. In fact, this rootkit was made the first one to break through 64-bit computers, but Microsoft sold the bypass of driver signing with a Windows update. A proxy server model. Well, there is a file called socks.tla that has been added to the TDSS SVC host.exe, the fake SVC host. It is used to establish a proxy server on an infected computer. This model facilitates the anonymous viewing of internet resources via infected machines. Having control over such a large number of computers with this function, the cyber criminals have started offering anonymous internet access as a service at a cost of roughly $100 per month. For the sake of convenience, cyber criminals have also developed a Firefox add-on that makes it easy to toggle between proxy servers within the browser. In order to support operation with 64-bit systems in the user mode, TDL4 contains a model called CMD64.DLL. A version of the CMD.ELO for 64-bit systems. However, due to the limitations of working with 64-bit programs, CMD.64.DLL code only provides communication with the botnet command and control servers. Also, the TDL4 rootkit is able to bypass driver signing by changing the boot options of Microsoft boot programs that will allow an unsigned driver to load. However, Microsoft has released an update of that. And that's why you do your Windows updates always. It's one step for security. Working with search engines. Well, the CDM data DL model remains almost completely unchanged. This model facilitates the communication with the portal command and control service and substitutes search results. For example, frequently manipulates advertising systems and search engines. The newest innovation in the list of commands for TDSS is the subname command, which assigns a number to each infected computer. For search engines and button network, TDSS uses the same fake click and traffic technologies as similar malicious programs. However, TDSS has the longest list of search engines for which it substitutes search results. When running, TDSS uses several sources to obtain lists of command and control server addresses. The default list is taken from CMD to DLL. If these addresses are inaccessible, then TDSS gets a list from cfg.ini, the config file. If for some reason no command and control server list is accessible, that list is created from an encrypted file called bckfg.tmp, which the port receives from the command and control server on first connection. Since the beginning of the year, around 60 command and control centers have been identified across the globe. Despite the steps taken by cybercriminals to protect the command and control centers, knowing the protocol TDL4 used to communicate with the servers makes it possible to create specially crafted requests and obtain statistics on the number of infected computers. Kaspersky Lab's analysis of data identified three different MySQL databases located in Moldova, Lithuania, and USA, all of which supported used proxy servers to support online. According to these databases, after the first 3 months of 2011, and alone, TDL4 infected 4.5 million computers around the world. I thought it was 1 month. Distribution of the TDL4 rootkit by country. Well, here's a graph showing that US have the most, most infections and other countries. So, yeah, you could possibly take a look at that. I'm not gonna go farther into it. Now, closing this presentation, I'd like to announce that TDL is still active as of today and is one of the most dangerous threats that, unfortunately, lots of antivirus software tend to miss. Always be careful, and remember that your first line of defense is always common sense. Special thanks to my personal experience, Kaspersky Lab securely sustainable software, VMware for testing, and Sandboxy for keeping track of that file.